House will now come to order. Please take your seats. Today we'll be led in prayer, saved by the phone. It's a robocall. Hate those things. Yeah, the warranty's up to date. Jackie knows how to get rid of those robocallers. Today we'll be led in prayer by Reverend Corey Rajek of the Fort Pierre Ministerial Association, and the page of the day is William Kessler of Pierre, and he'll lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So please rise.
Let us pray. Lord God, you have made these men and women to be legislators for our great state, yet this task is immense. And as time moves on, strength wanes and vigor fades. Grant to each of them a wise and discerning mind, that they may govern your people according to your will. Give them the endurance to do the right thing, even under pressure and opposition. And at the end of the day, give them a peaceful rest, that their bodies and minds may be refreshed for the work they have to do. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Clerk, please call the roll.
Representatives Anderson, Bartles, Barthel, Beal, Bordeaux, Borglum, Bruner, Chafee, Chase, Schwach, Dennert, Deutsch, Dietrich, Duba, Duval, Fink, Freimuller, Glanzer, Goodwin, Gosch, Lena Greenfield, Gross, Hammock, Hansen, Healy, Howard, Hunhop, Kevin Jensen, Johns, Chris Johnson, David Johnson, Carr, Toth, Latterell, Lesmeister, Livermont, Marty, McCleary, Mills, Milstead, Miss Gimmons, Mullally, Olson, Herman Otten, Overweg, Perry, Kent Peterson, Sue Peterson, Pischke, Post, Puyer, Qualm, Randolph, Rasmussen, Reed, Reimer, Ring, Round, Saba, Jamie Smith, St. John, Steele, Sullivan, Wangsness, Weiss, Weesey, Willitson, York, Zickman, Speaker Helgard.
Here.
Mr. Speaker, we have a quorum present.
Thank you. We'll move on to the approval of the journal.
Mr. Speaker, the committee on... Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Chief Clerk of the House has had under consideration the House Journal of the 19th day. All errors, typographical or otherwise, are duly marked in the Tipperary Journal for correction, and we hereby move the adoption of the report. Respectfully submitted, Stephen G. Helgard, Chair.
That motion having been made and seconded, discussion on the motion, hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. Is the doctor of the day in the gallery? Right up here. Dr. Jerome Bentz, he's a physician from Platt. He's part of the Doctor of the Day program sponsored by the South Dakota State Medical Association. Dr. Bentz is a family medicine physician who has served the medical needs community of Platt since 1983. He received his medical training from USD School of Medicine in 1980 and completed a family practice residency program in Cedar Rapids. In 1983, Dr. Bentz is a member of the South Dakota State Medical Association, the American Medical Association, and the Christian Medical and Dental Society. He enjoys working, running, biking, gardening, reading, and promoting Platt and the surrounding communities. Welcome, Dr. Bentz. We appreciate you being here. Communications.
Mr. Speaker and members of the House of Representatives, I have the honor to inform you that on February 12, 2020, I approved House Bills 1015, 1016, 1017, 1018, and 1030, and the same have been deposited in the Office of the Secretary of State. Respectfully submitted, Kristi Noem, Governor.
Move forward to messages from the Senate.
Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to return herewith House Bills 1024, 1027, and 1029, which have passed the Senate without change. Also, Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to transmit herewith Senate Bills 18, 19, 26, 33, 35, 113, 119, 124, 127, and 149, which have passed the Senate, and your favorable consideration is respectfully requested.
Motions and resolutions.
Representative Quall moved that the HCR 6002 be referred to the Committee on State Affairs.
That motion having been made and seconded, discussion on the motion.
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Bordeaux.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would ask you to resist this motion here. We did have this go to a committee. We had it go to State Tribal Relations Committee where we had a good discussion. I have a chairman of one of the tribes preparing some remarks for me, and they're looking forward to having it heard on the floor here. So I'd ask you to resist the motion.
All right, further remarks in regard to the motion? Representative Quall.
Well, thank you. Mr. Speaker, I would hope that you would support this. There was some information that we found out that felt it would be necessary to bring it to State Affairs to have it vetted a little further. Thank you.
All right, any further remarks in regard to the motion to remove HCR 6002 and refer it to the Committee on State Affairs? Hearing no further remarks, this is a motion and a voice vote. So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay.
Nay.
Motion carries.
Representative Quall moved that HCR 6012 and SCR 604 be deferred to Tuesday, February 18th, 2020, the 21st legislative day.
Second. That motion having been made and seconded, any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries.
Representative Quall moved that HB 1173 be deferred pending adoption of the corrected House Committee on Education report.
Motion being Representative Qualls' motion that HB 1173 be deferred pending adoption of the corrected House Committee on Education report. All those in favor, is there any discussion on the motion? Having been made and seconded. Hearing no discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. Consideration of reports of committees.
Representative Qualm moved that the reports on the Standing Committee on Commerce and Energy on House Bill 1073, as found on page 263 of the House Journal, also Judiciary on House Bill 1123, as found on page 264 of the House Journal, be adopted.
That motion having been made and seconded, any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. First reading of House bills.
The Speaker declared that House Bill 1273 was withdrawn at the request of the prime sponsor pursuant to Joint Rule 6B-1.1. Representative Qualm moved that House Bill 1241 be referred from the Committee on Judiciary to the Committee on Local Government.
That motion having been made and seconded, any discussion on the motion? Representative Bruner.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would just ask that the body concur with this. The chairman of Judiciary is happy to give it up. The chairman of local government is happy to take it. I'm the prime sponsor. I'm happy to send it there, and I think the speaker's happy to let us do that. So everybody should be happy.
It all is good. Any further discussion on that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay.
Aye.
Motion carried. Apparently not everyone was happy. Moving on to first reading Senate bills. For those in the gallery, this is a constitutional obligation to have a first reading and a second reading of all bills. And this complies with that constitutional requirement. All these bills will be noted on the website, so you can read the entire bill, and all that's being read right now is just really the title of the bill. So that is what we're accomplishing. I'll just mention, too, that if you have interest in specific bills, you can follow those on our legislative website. It's sdlegislature.gov. And you can go to that website to listen to the committee hearings. You can even find out when it's going to be heard. And if you want to be involved even over the phone, you can do that. So that's an opportunity for everybody to know what's going on here in the legislature. Speaker signs to House Health and Human Services Senate Bill 4. Second reading, consent calendar items.
House Bill 1165, revised provisions regarding the acceptance of gifts by municipalities. House Bill 1009, revised provisions regarding failure to comply with outpatient commitment or treatment orders. House Bill 1011, require certain examinations of persons awaiting involuntary commitment hearings. Senate Bill 62, revise the membership and responsibilities of the South Dakota Board on geographic names. Senate Bill 8, revise certain provisions regarding insurance holding companies. I gotta get it up.
Items on the consent calendar are reported out of committee with no dissenting votes or opposition and are not subject to debate. However, there may be questions asked of the sponsors of each of these bills. Are there any questions? Hearing no questions, the question now before the House is final passage of the bills on the consent calendar. Those in favor will vote yay. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. Representative Gush.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is my pleasure, on the behalf of Representative Wangsness and myself from the Great White North of District 23, to introduce to you Caitlin Westfall. She is the 2019 South Dakota State Rodeo Ambassador. She is just directly above the clock. She is a 16-year-old daughter of Wes and Christy Westfall of Leola, South Dakota. She is a junior in high school. Caitlin has enjoyed traveling all over the state, talking about and representing 4-H and the great sport of rodeo. Please help me in welcoming our 2019 South Dakota State Rodeo Queen, Kate Westfall.
Representative Glanzer.
I have two personal privileges today.
Granted.
The first one, our tummies are full from the great dinner and lunch provided by the South Dakota Library Association. And they're here today. They exist to support libraries and librarians throughout the state. And I think they're seated right up over here.
Welcome.
Thank you. The other personal privilege, maybe not quite so dramatic and as the radio announcer, sports announcer, but I do have a blessing here today with my family sitting up over here. I have my daughter, Sally, and her son over there, Brecken, or Carson, one of the two, and Brecken, the other grandson, sitting in the middle, and her husband, Brad. They're here from Kansas, Heston, Kansas, and then my dear wife of almost 52 years, Penny. Glad to have you here this week.
Welcome. And we called in the bitter cold just to make sure you knew why you moved to Kansas.
Representatives Chafee, Johns, Marty, Mullally. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were 65 yeas, 0 nays, and 5 excused.
Consent bills having received majority vote of the members elect are hereby declared passed. Are there any questions regarding any of the titles? Hearing none, the titles are deemed correct.
Representative Paul moved that Senate Bill 54 be placed to precede House Bill 1014 on today's calendar.
That motion having been made and seconded, are there any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Motion carries. So there being no objection, the House will proceed to order business number 14, which is the second reading of Senate bills.
Senate Bill 54 is an act to regulate the use of auxiliary containers.
Senate Bill 54, having had its second readings, up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Representative Post.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I bring to you Senate Bill 54. The provisions in Chapter 34A-7 and 34A-6 through 68, which this bill amends, relate to uniform recycling codes for plastic containers and create preemptions of all laws by any other political subdivisions of the state for relating to beverage containers, garbage bags, or plastic packaging materials. This bill simply refines the definition, adding auxiliary containers and plastic straws to these lists. An auxiliary container is well defined in painstaking detail in the second part of this bill. And if I may simplify that a bit, it's a way to deliver a product. It's a grocery bag, a drink cup, a dry cleaner's bag, a takeout box, a plastic straw. It's a clean, safe, affordable way to get the groceries home, the clothes home from the cleaners, the dinner home, and have a refreshing drink on the way there. In Senate committee, we were able to hear testimony from my cousin Brett on how ensuring readily available plastic straws are absolutely necessary for those with disabilities due to the possible dangerous complications with the alternatives. Someone who owns convenience stores in Sioux Falls and T or Brookings and Volga should be able to buy the same supplies for both stores. What we're doing here today will allow small business owners the ability to operate in South Dakota in a similar fashion to what the Interstate Commerce Clause allows business owners to operate with similar rules across state lines. Our universities and private business are diligently pursuing biodegradable plastics based on earth-friendlier options. Bans of any kind are premature because they will stifle innovation of the next generation of plastic auxiliary containers that are desired by the marketplace. With this, I will ask for your green vote.
Thank you very much for the remarks in regard to Senate Bill 54. Representative Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So when we're talking about bans on plastic, I don't really understand why we would be doing this on a state level. This is a local control issue. And as far as I'm aware, there has not been a single city, county, or municipality that has attempted to do a ban. I know there was conversation of it in Brookings, but to my knowledge, the city council did not even vote on it. So again, we are searching for a solution in search of a problem that does not exist. And according to PBS, they did a study on plastic and plastic bags. And after 3 years of these plastic products, plastic bags specifically, they tested them in four different environments: garden soil, outdoors, submerged in salt water in a marina, left exposed to daylight in open air, or sealed in a dark container in a temperature-controlled lab. And even after 27 months, none of these decomposed completely except for the plant-based bags, which is not what we are even talking about. So this is not good for our state. We should not be taking away local control on an issue like this. If there is a city or a town or a county or a municipality that wants to have a conversation about banning certain products, we should allow them to do that. And this is not going to stifle innovation. That I don't understand how that would stifle innovation. There's already seven states in our country that have put bans on plastic bags, and there are over 350 counties and municipalities that have put bans on plastics and styrofoams, and there has been no stifling of innovation. So that argument just is not a point that should be looked at when you're voting on this bill. And when we talk about, you know, takeout containers and beverages, and you want to go get a cold drink or a hot coffee, well, those are often mostly, I mean, all the coffee companies already are using paper products. And there are already, for decades, for example, Chinese takeout boxes are made of paper. They're not made of plastic. There are already other options for takeout containers that are biodegradable. So I think this is a bill about local control, and I think it is a solution in search of a problem that does not exist. And I hope you really look at this, because we talk about local control and how important it is, and that we shouldn't be legislating something that shouldn't be legislated. This is one of those things. So I urge you to please vote against this bill. It is not good for our state. It is not good for our counties, our municipalities, or our cities. Please vote red. Thank you.
Thank you. Further remarks? Any further remarks? Representative Reed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In regards to the ban on bans, I remember the first person said that to me, I got a little stuck. What's a ban on a band? It's a, I don't know if it's band squared or what. But this is a decision that should and has been made at the local level at times. There are, you know, we talk about that Brookings has looked at it, but there's also been times where it said, no, we're not gonna do this. And I feel that it comes down to the community itself and what they wanna be when they present themselves. And I know that it's not good to have these bans. I mean, I disagree with the bans. And the reason I disagree on them is that I know grocery stores. The minute you start talking about having these bans, and I have a lot of people in their communities around across South Dakota, I wish we had one more grocery store, or I wish we had a grocery store. The minute you enact those bans, they start looking at you and saying, now wait a minute, it's gonna be tougher to do business there. So these bans don't make sense to cities, but if a city wants to go ahead and do it, let them do it. Also, I know there's been some discussion about plastic straws and for those that are disabled, and I know that communities that, like the city of Brookings, they take a look at disability rules first when it comes to anything like this, and I can't see them fully, completely banning plastic straws just for that reason that was stated. But again, then the locals will decide that. The locals will realize that's the right thing to do. We also, I heard the discussion that it comes down to the individual person. What do they want to do? They can make the choice. Well, yet when we were talking about hemp, there was a lot of arguments that, well, this isn't viable, so we shouldn't do it. Well, let the individual decide then. And so we get in conflict there. And so I believe this is a good thing to have at the local government level. Let them decide. Let them decide what their community is going to be like. And then let the chips fall where they may and see how the community does. So I'd urge you to vote no on this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Bruner.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I really like this bill. The more I look at it, the more we talk about it, the more I like it, because you know, it allows businesses to serve their customers. And it doesn't allow municipalities or any other form of government to get in the way of that. It also allows customers, who's the ultimate local control, to decide how and where they want to spend their dollars. And to me, that's what's important here, is allowing a free flow of business. When you have chain grocery stores and whatnot, we don't need to be getting in their way of serving their customers and doing what's best for business. That's why little towns don't have grocery stores anymore, is because people get in the way and they can't do things that are profitable to them. So with that, I like the bill. I think we ought to vote green on it. Thanks.
Thank you. Representative McCleary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I'm going to agree with the good representative from Brookings. And it is more personal, just a very personal issue. I've started myself taking the large cloth bag and going to the store. You don't have to use plastic. But the other thing, keep in mind, my tribe has a plastic plant. They're incorporating anywhere from 10 to 15% hemp into those plastic bags. And are they going to be biodegradable? Could very well be. We need to go there. So I am going to ask you to vote no on this, mainly because of business and because of what I'm hearing from my district. Thank you.
Representative Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. To all of the members here who have expressed concerns over local control and support for local control, and to all of you who will after me, possibly, I would like to say I rise in agreement with you. I'd like to read a quote from Ayn Rand. She said, "The smallest minority on earth is the individual. Those who deny individual rights cannot claim to be defenders of minorities." And for all of you who would like to defend the rights of local control, I just appeal to you that we get down to the business. I'm a business person. Yes, I believe that is local control, but why not take it even further, down to the individual, and follow that principle? This bill is not about plastic bags. This bill is about principles. And I urge you to consider that when you vote on this. And I would urge you to vote green on this, because it is in support of local control of the rights of the individual. Thank you.
Thank you. Further remarks, Representative Schwach.
Well,
I think one thing we're not talking about is another important section in the bill, and also land use and sewage issues, our landfill issues, excuse me. You know, we're going to put this into law, and I can anticipate an issue because we had this in Yankton for a long time where you had to figure out where you're going to put your trash. Where were you going to put it? And we had to enter into a joint agreement for Vermilion, and it goes somewhere else now. But by doing this, we're effectively tying the hands of our local officials who actually know what's going into their dumps and know how best to regulate that use. I mean, this goes beyond just the issue of what can and cannot be served in a store. And there are good public policy reasons for why a community may want to look at regulating what can and cannot be used in the store, particularly as it relates to where you're going to put it. You know, are you going to put it in your community? What happens when you're running out of space? Those are important issues to think about. The second thing I want to point out that hasn't been mentioned here, if you look at Section 1, the bottom of it, it talks about you cannot you cannot have an ordinance that restricts the use of glass bottles and containers within a park or recreation sites and facilities due to public safety concerns. Now, my community of Yankton just passed an opt-out to build a brand new pool, a $10 million pool. And as I read this, right now, you should come. we'll go down the slide together. As I read that sentence, my community cannot prohibit a young person or an adult who's maybe had too much from having a glass bottle right next to the water. Now, what happens when he drops that bottle and it shatters and it goes into the water? That's a big little issue that we're overlooking here. Communities should be able to restrict where glass bottles can and cannot be in parks. And that's in the bill. We're banning that too. And so for my district, when I think about that $10 million pool and the fact that they're not going to be able to control what goes into that pool anymore, basically, and the risk of shattered glass, I don't even know what it would cost to clean that up. But I don't think it would be cheap. I think it would be rather tough. So I strongly encourage you to think not only about just the principles of local control, but think about the policy behind this and where communities are going to be in 10, 20 years. Whether you're for recycling, against recycling, whether you're for plastics or against plastics, you know, our dumps aren't getting smaller, they're getting bigger. And at certain points, I could see where a local community might have to say, you know what, we do have to look at prohibiting certain items because they're filling up our dump. So please vote red. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Lesmeister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And just a question for the prime sponsor.
Go ahead and state your question.
Just for clarification, so if this bill passes and signed into law, and I'm just going to pick a town then because it brought up, say, Brookings wants to ban plastic bags, can they?
Representative Post, do you wish to answer that question, or did you hear the question? Would you restate that, please?
If a city would, if this law is passed and signed into law, could a city or municipality then ban plastic bags, just for clarification?
No, they would not.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, another question?
Go ahead.
Do you have any proof of a store or a business going broke because they could not use plastic bags or certain items like this?
Representative Post, do you wish to answer the question?
I wouldn't necessarily say going broke, but it definitely would be a cost prohibiting factor. If you had to buy certain set of products in order for one store in Brookings, for example, or if you had to have it and you had several stores in the surrounding community that you all owned and had to bring services in, now you're buying different products in different levels of bulk and therefore causing problems that way. It's just a regulatory burden.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just a comment then, please.
Yes, go ahead.
Well, the way I look at this, and we just talked about local control, I think we just took local control away if we pass this, because the question is, could a local store or city, municipality, ban an item? And he said no.
That's loss of local control, period. I don't know how you can get around it or anything else. It took all local control away from that municipality or city. Second question was posed to me by somebody at home. We're already offering different products. We heard the good representative behind me say that he takes his bag that they give you. Some places do already. Local grocery stores are already saying plastic or paper. So they're already offering these products already, whether it's cost prohibitive or not. A lot of these already have them. Hemp was brought up. Yeah, maybe we're going to move towards that. Let's give them that chance. But if you really want to talk about local control, the prime sponsor answered the question, you're taking it all away from them. Because that city can't even make the decision. They don't even need to have the conversation. They can't have it. Because it does not matter, because this state body is looking to ban that. So I vote no on this. I hope you vote no on it. And leave it in local control, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Borglum. It'll work without you. I've done that before.
Too much caffeine and sugar today. Well, so a couple of points on this, the ban on the ban bill. This makes for excellent Thursday afternoon conversation. And I was reminded when my good seatmate here from Pennington County was talking about getting all the way down to the individual. And I've always understood local control to just pertain to political subdivisions, not individual people, because we'd end up in anarchy if all of us truly went our own way. And I was also reminded of the mighty octopus, who's when one arm misbehaves, another arm pulls it off, which doesn't bode well for anybody. So rather than pulling our arms off over this bill, Sam's Club does not provide any plastic bags. They don't, in fact, provide anything except spent cardboard containers that you can load your spouse up with and shuffle them out the front door. So this doesn't strike me as a crisis in South Dakota. We don't have any cities or municipalities who are enacting it. I know that we like to throw our phrases around, whether it's a solution in search of a problem or local control or not local control, but holy smokes, people, we're not even doing this in South Dakota. So if you want to vote for it, I vote for it, but I know that my city and municipality, they don't have any interest in banning plastic, but they would just like to know why we here in the South Dakota State Legislature are worrying about what city governments and municipalities are supposed to be worrying about. So, I don't know, shop at Sam's Club if you want to, or not. Marty's, my good representative from Bonham, Douglas, Hanson, Hutchinson, McCook is shaking his head no. I'm a fan of small local grocery stores. Bring your bags if you're so inclined. But this really isn't a problem in South Dakota. So just food for thought.
Thank you, Representative Beal.
I defer my time to the bill's prime sponsor. Thank you.
Wait, just one second. I think Representative Reed had indicated to me that he was requesting to speak a second time prior to that. So Representative Reed, if you have something concise to address.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'll be really quick here. I want to thank the good representative from Yankton. He reminded me of something, and that there is an unintended consequence with this bill, and I hadn't thought about it till today. I'd forgot about this situation. It was time to start looking at building or digging, finding a spot for a new solid waste facility in Brookings, and that's extremely expensive. And we started years ahead of time, you know, looking at this because of the cost. And you do that because guess what? You got to start increasing the costs for the actual picking up of the trash. You have to start raising the rates, and you got to start saving money if you're going to build another dump because of the expense. What we found, the reason we didn't have to do that, and this was getting a little lucky because we don't have anything that's mandatory, but because of all the recycling, we realized that our consumption of the dump space was going down rapidly, and we didn't have to do this for I forget how many extra years. It's where we could absolutely forget about doing this. So a ban like this, anytime you start banning something like this, there is the chance that you're actually forcing more costs on the individual. You're making the city have to actually raise the costs of services, which is almost a tax on the service. So that's another reason why I ask you to defeat this bill. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker, for allowing me to speak.
Yep. I will invite Representative Post to close this out.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First of all, I would like to address the issue about glass and pools. That entire section there has, it actually reads in line 13, nothing in 34A-6-59, and there's another number there, inclusive, may be construed to limit a political subdivision from allowing or requiring specially designated garbage bags and the purpose of identifying volume or the type of waste, or restricting the use of glass bottles and containers within park or recreation sites and the facility due to the public safety concerns. So that's not a valid excuse there. We have a temporary problem with recycling plastics as far as these plastics going into our dumps. We had a supply chain where it was going to China. It will take a little bit for the US to retool and get back into this recycling these bags until we get to that biodegradable option. So I don't really think that's a short-term problem as far as what we've got right now. It's just something we were kind of funny, really, when you think about it. You've got a little plastic bag, you bundle it up, and you ship it all the way to China, and then ship it all the way back here as a form of something else, and that's our environmental decisions we're making. I can't see how that's really saving a whole lot of anything, but... there's nothing in this bill that allows littering. That's wrong. No one likes to see it. It's not really, there's nothing in this bill that concerns that. And I guess I want to say, if your case against plastic bags is so strong, simply take those ideas to the people, let them know about it, and they will decide with their pocketbooks and their shopping choices. Senate Bill 54 just simply returns the decision-making to the most local of governing, yourself. Thank you, and please vote green.
Thank you. Hearing no further remarks, question for the House, final passage, Senate Bill 54. Those in favor will vote yay. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine, and the members will proceed to vote.
Otten votes nay. Representative Olson, Representative Randolph. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were 30 yeas, 33 nays, and 7 excused.
Senate Bill 54, having failed to receive majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared lost. Intent to reconsider. There being no objection, the House will revert to order business number 13, which is in regard to our second reading of House bills and joint resolutions.
Representative Quall moved that House Bill 1117 be placed to follow House Bill 1205 on today's calendar.
That motion having been made and seconded, any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries.
Representative Quall moved that House Bills 1036 and 1079 be deferred to Tuesday, February 18th, 2020, the 21st legislative day. Also, House Bill 1104 be deferred to Thursday, February 20th, 2020, the 23rd legislative day.
Seconds have to be made from the House floor. It sounded like it's out in the hall. That motion having been made and seconded, all those in favor say aye. Or discussion of the motion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries.
House Bill 1014, an act to place certain substances on the controlled substances schedule and to declare an emergency.
House Bill 1014, having had its second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks? And also, this is a two-thirds majority vote required. That's why it was removed from the consent calendar. Any remarks? Representative Ms. Gimmons.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the body, this is an annual bill from the Department of Health bringing South Dakota's controlled substance schedule into compliance with federal drug laws. We'd ask your support on this bill, and we hope it's not as much of a talker as the last one.
I'm sure somebody could distinguish the elements of each one of these. Any further remarks in regard to House Bill 1014? Hearing no further remarks, question for the House, final passage of House Bill 1014. All those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. And again, this is a two-thirds vote requirement. Representative Pischke. Granted.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As I was going through the House calendar today, and looking at the bills to vote on the House floor, I couldn't help but remembering a good friend and former legislator, Dan Kaiser, as he came across this bill. And, you know, and Dan and his son, Jax. Jax has leukemia and is really going through a lot of things and going through bone marrow transplant. And if you follow Team Jax on Facebook, I encourage everybody watching to do so and go cheer for him because he's really battling the fight for his life. And so, you know, I wanted to take this moment, as this bill was upon us today, to just take a moment to remember Jax and to pray for him, and, you know, just keep him in the prayers because he's really battling out there. And just as a symbol of my appreciation and my friendship for Dan was always one that would have a little bit different stance on things that we would do here in this body. How would he approach government? And there's probably myself and maybe a few others in this body who are going to vote no on this bill for Dan. So please keep Jackson in your prayers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Let's finish voting. Representative Pischke, can you tell me what is the status? Because I haven't looked on Facebook for a while about him.
Well, I know that he did have a successful bone marrow transplant just recently. It takes a while for those the cells to start regenerating in Jackson's bone marrow, and it's very slow, but the progress is looking up at this point in time, but it's just a very slow go of it, I guess, so to say. But we just keep praying that, you know, he doesn't really have any immune system at this point in time, so any time he might get sick, it could be really, really bad. So just keep praying that he stays with good health and keeps progressing for the better.
Thank you. I think I'll take a moment and I'll pray for Jackson, and you can join in if you'd like. Lord, we just pray that you'll be in the midst of the Kaiser family and all the challenges they have, that you'd oversee the chemotherapy and all the things that go on, the bone marrow transplant and all those things that are so difficult for anyone, especially for a little boy. We pray for his mom and dad and his siblings, and just ask that you'd support them and encourage them today. We pray for positive results, that Jackson would be strengthened and this cancer would be pushed back and that he would be healed. And we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to pray for a friend and remember the challenges that they're going through. In Jesus' name, amen. You might also remember in prayer Rob Wiley, too. Rob was heading up the retirement system and retired, and just recently found himself also battling cancer. So that is what they're about these days. They're staying in as much as possible to avoid the possibility of infections and colds. So remember Rob Wiley and his wife Sarah.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were 56 yeas, 7 nays, and 7 excused.
House Bill 1014, having received more than a two-thirds majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions in regard to the title? Hearing none, the title is deemed correct.
House Bill 1159 is an act to revise provisions regarding the referral of opt-outs made by school districts.
House Bill 1159, having had its second reading, is up for consideration, final passage. Are there any remarks? Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, after that engaging conversation we had about the ban on bans, I bring you what I've heard called today the opt-out of opt-outs. So redundancy, I think, is the word of the day. That's what flew through my mind. So this is a constituent bill that's about tax fairness. It's about local control, another word we're using a lot today, and giving the people a say on the taxes that they pay. Here's a little bit of the background. In 2002, the law was changed that requires any opt-out that happens after that time to include the amount of money that's going to be requested and the duration that it's being requested for. And the law even goes so far as to dictate what the advertisement in the newspaper will say, and even right down to the size of the type to make sure it's not in the fine print. And that ad has to read, "Attention taxpayers, notice of property tax increase of," and then they have to fill in the amount. The advertisement in the paper also has to let the taxpayer know that they have the option to refer to a vote of the people that opt-out that their governing body passed. But opt-outs that occurred prior to 2002 in the school district realm were left alone. And I've heard some of those people call them perpetual opt-outs. In doing some of the research that I did for this bill, there are 30 of those across the state. A few districts have more than one.
But out of the, and I forget, 140 some school districts that we have, there are only 30 of these opt-outs that are out there. But to me, that when I heard them referred to as a perpetual opt-out, that just seemed wrong. A perpetual opt-out is really a tax increase, and one that the voters never had a chance to vote on after the law was changed. Investigating this further, the district where my constituents contacted me on, they did the research and they said, you know, 71% of the taxpayers within the district are new. They weren't even taxpayers in 2002. And so these opt-outs that exist from back then, they have never had a chance to vote on. And that didn't seem right to me. And I would guess that it's likely true in other, that kind of changeover in the taxpayers is likely the same in other parts of the state. So House Bill 1159 really would give voters the option of referring any of these pre-July 2002 school district opt-outs to a vote. It's not an easy process. It requires gathering signatures. If you've ever had to do that, like we're doing now, if you're seeking re-election, that takes effort. And so I believe that if we pass this law, it will be used very little. But it is, I believe, an important tool for the taxpayers to have. These people should have a say in the taxes that they pay. So I hope you'll join me and give the taxpayers this tool and vote green on House Bill 1159. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Representative Duvall.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have an amendment, 1159D, for Duvall. It has been distributed, and I move it at this time.
That motion having been made and seconded, discussion on the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This really is a technical amendment, not a substantive amendment. When the bill was originally drafted, it came to our committee in the section of code that deals with general opt-outs for counties. This amendment would put it in the section of code that deals specifically with school opt-outs. So with that, I would ask for your support of this amendment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Further remarks in regard to the amendment of House Bill 1159 and with the 1159D as in Duvall. Representative Mills.
I just thought I should let you know that this would be considered friendly.
Very good, thank you. Any further remarks? All those, and hearing no further remarks, all those in favor of the amendment to 1159 with 1159D, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed nay. Motion carries. Further remarks in regard to House Bill 1159 as amended with 1159D. Representative Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the body. As I promised the prime sponsor of this bill last night at one of the receptions, I'm standing to oppose this measure. The local school district has the opportunity to elect new school board members and change whatever opt-out financial arrangement they want. We don't need a state law to take care of a situation in one school district. And I think, I don't remember whether he mentioned it, I think there's only 30 of these perpetual opt-outs still on the books across the state. And there's one small school district that's complaining about it. I've got a couple in my district that have these, and they don't want to lose the option to keep that opt-out. So let's let this be a local control issue, allow the school boards to manage their finances the way they want to, and the people of the district to elect the school board members that they want to serve their school district. Please vote red. Thank you.
Thank you for the remarks, Representative Reed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just adding on to the comments of the good representative from Hudson, I serve on the tax committee and listen to the testimony. And we were given some written testimony about this bill. And the reason I voted against it is this comes down to an issue that they're having about something else. In this written testimony, it talks about how they feel that, you know, that there should be a reorganization or they should dissolve the district. That's what they're looking at doing. They also, this gentleman also commented that the, and this is in the record, that there are 69 students that are being bused from two Minnesota school districts. And they have an issue with that because it's a very small district. They've bused people in. They're wondering, should the district, you know, still be there? And I agree, that's a great conversation. But it comes down to that school board. Everybody there can elect a different school board member. They can have a, they can make this an election issue and say, we shouldn't have this school interest this anymore. And that's how they need, that's how they need to handle this. Starving them just to get to where they want is not fair. And then what's going to happen here is they can come back every year. You know, with signatures are pretty easy to get. They can come back every year, and then you got another $10,000, another $10,000. You got the cost of the election, you know, to get the issue. And so I think that this is a local issue that they're having, and they need to figure out what they want to do and don't bother with all the other schools and how they're functioning. So I would ask you to please defeat this bill. Thank you.
Representative McCleary.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm going to agree with the two previous speakers, especially the one from Brookings. That is absolutely correct. This is a consolidation issue. And be very careful where you go leaving small schools, because if they lose that opt-out, they lose that money. I've heard from three schools in my district, in District 1, Representative St. John and myself. Vote no on this, because that's opt-out money. You need to be very careful on a slippery slope where we're going here. Please vote no. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Ring.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This will be really quick. I agree this is a consolidation issue. This is not really an opt-out issue. What it would do would be to make the situation more unstable for those districts that have the opt-out and need the opt-out. This just isn't necessary. Thank you.
Thank Vote you. No. Representative Howard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a great bill. And I'm going to disagree with the prior speakers and ask you, urge you to please vote yes on this. This is, I don't believe it's about consolidation. This is about giving citizens a voice that haven't had a voice in how many years? I mean, these opt-outs have been on the books for how long? These citizens don't have a voice. And yes, the school boards could vote to eliminate these, but we all know no school board would ever vote to eliminate this. Why would they? This is a pot of money that they've gotten used to spending. But this will give back the control and give a voice to the citizens and allow them to have a say in this. And if the opt-out is such a great thing, then let the school board prove it to the citizens and let them get the citizens' support. If it's a great thing, the citizens will support it. So please allow the citizens to have a voice on this.
Thank you. Representative Miskimmons.
Just to note, this doesn't always apply to small school districts. Mitchell is one of the communities that did this opt-out before 2002. It's been a great asset to the community. It was heavily debated in the community. There was opposition because it was perpetual. That was emphasized. The people voted. They voted for the opt-out. The school board has handled the monies responsibly, many years not using the opt-out when it wasn't needed. So I would ask for your no vote on this bill.
Thank you for the remarks, Representative Gosch.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm going to say a lot of the things that had, well, I'm going to try not to say a lot of the things that have been said already. I'm going to rewind it back to 2000. My father was the president of the school board, and this is how ranchy things get in Selby, South Dakota. The school board at that point in time said they're going to do away with the perpetual opt out. So we would like to propose this to the public because we know that Peer's just going to take it back from us eventually, and they're going to take more money away from us. So if you guys think we should do this so we have a little security, vote yes. If you don't, vote no. And I think it was like 80, 90% of the people voted for it. And I'll tell you, we don't have a giant influx of new people into our town. But talking about a voice of the people, we also have budget hearings every year, right? We've got budget hearings every year. And in 20 years that we've had that, zero people have ever complained about it or talked about it or anything. The opt-outs seem to always pass anyway. They continue to go through. I just find it ironic that I'm sitting here in Peer 20 years after the community said, we know that Peer's gonna screw this up, and I'm down here, and that's an opportunity that might happen today. So I would urge you guys, this is a local thing. These are locally elected individuals. We operate under a constitutional republic. These people represent their people. Let's let them make those decisions. Vote not, vote no.
Thank you for the remarks. Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I'd like to address a couple of the concerns that were raised. First, it was said that you can just vote in new school board members. And that's true, but that's only one of the tools that citizens have on any other opt-out. On any other opt-out, they can change school board members, but they can also refer the opt-out to a vote. And so why would we limit them to just one of those tools? Let's give them this extra tool that all the other opt-outs have, which is to say they have the opportunity to take it to a vote. The other comment that came up was that, well, they could just refer it to a vote every year just to kind of annoy the school board, I suppose, and it would cost some money to do that. That's not true, actually. If it gets referred to a vote, then it would fall under the statute that I described to you that requires a notice in the paper of the opt-out, the duration of time that it's going to be for, and so it brings it forward into the current law. So that part's not true. It can only be a one-time thing on every one of these that would be referred. And I guess finally, I would just say that you heard about school districts that are very happy with their opt-out, that voted it strongly through, but that was 20 years ago, or nearly 20 years ago. And if they're happy still today, they won't refer these, and they'll continue to be happy. And I would guess that this will be used very, very little. But it is a tool that's not only good for the constituents in one district, one school district within my legislative district, but it's a tool that should be available to all of these 30 districts that have a perpetual opt-out. So I encourage your green vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Hearing no further remarks, question for the House, final passage of House Bill 1159, as amended with 1159D. All those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Gosh votes nay. Mullally votes aye. Representative Wangsness. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were 19 yeas, 44 nays, and 7 excused.
House Bill 1159, as amended with 1159D, having failed to receive majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared lost. I'll just mention, too, I notice Anita Thomas was in just a few minutes ago to speak with someone, and you might want to extend your sympathies to Ms. Thomas today. Her mother passed away earlier today. So. Representative Qualm.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move we defer the remainder of the calendar till February 18th, the 21st legislative day.
That motion having been made and seconded, any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay.
No!
One no from Representative Rounds. Motion carries. There being no objection, the House will proceed to order business number, revert to order business number 5, reports of standing committees. Please give your attention to the clerk.
Mr. Speaker, The Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that it reports that HB 1006, 1022, 1038 were delivered to Her Excellency the Governor for her approval at 9:52 a.m. February 13th, 2020. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Office of Engrossing and Enrolling has carefully compared HB 1024, 1027, and 1029 and finds the same correctly enrolled. Respectfully submitted, Stephen G. Halgard, Chair. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Education respectfully submits the following corrected report for this committee action of February 10th, 2020. House Bill 1152, 2 Bass, House Bill 1157 and 1173 do pass as amended. Only House Bill 1173 will be reflected on the calendar. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Retirement Laws respectfully reports that Senate Bill 9 do pass, Senate Bill 31, 32, and 34 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. Larry Zickman, Chair. Also, the Committee on Agriculture and Natural Resources respectfully reports that House Bill 1095 do pass as amended. House Bill 1111 was tabled. House Bill 1257 was due pass. House Bill 1181 was due pass and be placed on the consent calendar. Thomas J. Bruner, Chair. Also, the Committee on Taxation respectfully reports the House Bill 1260 do pass as amended and be placed on the consent calendar. House Bill 1274 was deferred to the 41st legislative day. Mark Willitson, Chair. Also, the Joint Committee on Appropriations respectfully reports that House Bill 1034 do pass as amended, House Bill 1090 do pass. House Bills 1102 and 1217 were tabled. Chris G. Carr, co-chair. Also, the Committee on Transportation respectfully reports that House Bill 1169 do pass as amended, House Bill 1170 do pass, and House Bill 1209 was tabled. John Mills, chair.
Speaker signing Senate Bill number 23, an act to repeal the high school graduation or equivalent requirement for certain licensed professionals. The Speaker signing House Bill number 1024, an act to make an appropriation for the payment of extraordinary litigation expenses and to declare an emergency. The Speaker is signing House Bill number 1027, an act to make an appropriation from the Coordinated Natural Resources Conservation Fund to the State Conservation Commission and to declare an emergency. The Speaker is signing House Bill number 1029, an act to make an appropriation for costs related to suppression of wildfires in the state and to declare an emergency. All right, other announcements? Representative Bruner.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Ag will meet Tuesday morning at 6:45 Mountain Time.
Representative Otten.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House local governments will not be meeting at 9 o'clock Mountain Time Tuesday. No meeting.
Representative Carr.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. Joint Committee on Appropriations will meeting Tuesday, and starting at 8 o'clock, we'll hear from the Investment Council, preceded by the Retirement System. Following that will be BHR, and then we'll also hear from the State Employee Compensation and Health Insurance.
Well, that sounds like fun. Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Transportation will meet on Tuesday morning, 10 a.m. We've got three bills, and there are going to be some conversations, so be on time.
Very good. Thank you, Representative Jensen.
Thank you. Health and Human Services will meet at 7:45. Please be there on time. We have a very full morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative York, are you going to make an announcement? No, that's fine. Okay. Representative Duba, any announcements? It's fine. Representative Latterell. Yes, Representative Steele. That motion having been made and seconded, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
I said, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
If anybody's opposed to it,
no.
I said, if anybody's opposed to it, they can say no. But it's too late. Goodbye.